I was about 17, 18 maybe, then I started thinking it would be pretty kind of good to be in a band, but I never really had any ambition, you know, except not to work, because I hated working. Me and this guy, Jim Beattie, we just wanted to play music, and we started off using a public image album, Metal Box, which was a silver film canister, using that as a drum, putting it through an echo unit. I would play that, and Jim would play like a... He'd get his bass and put it through a fuzz pedal to distort it, and he'd make tapes of screaming and stuff, smashing up bits of metal. I don't know, I just wanted to make some noise. First gig I played with Primal Scream was the first gig I played with the Jesus Mary tune, which was October the 12th, 1984, I think, at the venue in Sucky Hall Street in Glasgow. It's the only gig I can remember the day of.
And it was with the Jesus and Mary Chain that the young Bobby Gillespie had his first real taste of success.
When we were formed Primal Scream, me and this guy Jim that I formed the band with, went to this club run by a guy called Nick, who was a friend of Andrew Innes's, and he gave us a tape by a band called the Daisy Chain, and he said, he goes, I don't like it, but I think you guys might like it.
On the other side of the tape were things like the 13th Floor Elevators and Sid Barrett, and he gave it to Bobby, knowing that he liked that music, and of course he listened to us and loved it and called my number, which was on the tape.
I spoke to Douglas Hart for 2 hours, you know, with so much in common.
I kind of put the icing on the cake on Bobby's mind. I became like a guy, you know.
The Mary Chain had the whole lot. They had the sex, they had the swagger, they were exciting, they caused loads of trouble at the gigs, and they had the songs as well. And I think Bobby was really important in that.
They wanted me to be their full-time drummer, but they wanted me to leave the Primal Scream. So it was quite a hard decision, but I just stayed.
But staying with the Scream was quite a gamble, as their early releases hadn't exactly taken the music world by storm.
The worth of the first two records, I mean, that's infinitely debatable, but for a lot of bands it will take you maybe one or two albums, maybe even three albums, to get to the point where you've realised exactly what your strengths are.
We're just going to try to find our way. Find our own, you know, our own voice, and find a way of writing songs and stuff. I never really had a good time, to be honest with you. It was pretty hard. Never really enjoyed that.
I liked him. Some pretty strange haircuts, strange fashion sense. It took me to join the show, I'm out of dress, man.
Come on, baby, shake.
Creation, Primal Scream were two pillars that ran concurrent with each other and right in the middle of the British music scene all the time as well. They kind of held the fort for a long time.
Creation Records allowed Primal Scream to be Primal Scream, you know.
He's been more of an inspiration than an influence. He's always been there when we needed him. He's great, he's a great man.
But then again, I don't know if anybody could stop Primal Scream being Primal Scream. They may well have went to somebody like EMI and been successful, but I don't know if any major that would stick with a band for 6.5 years.
Shake it to the east, shake it to the west.
I'm burnt out on a professional level with them. I mean, I could never work with them professionally ever, ever again. After you work with somebody for 17 years or whatever, you know, I would never want to go back into that business relationship with them ever again. But if you're talking about it on a personal level, then, you know, I love them as people, but I'm especially friendly with Bobby and Andrew, do you know what I mean, you know, and, like, you know, we still see each other quite a lot and we're there for each other if anybody needs help, you know.